Assalamu alaikum, students. Today we will start chapter number 2 and lecture number 8, which is the application layer. We had an introduction about the network in our chapter 1, and we looked some of the terminologies which will be used in this course, and we had an overview of the layered structure of the OSI model and the TCP/IP model. Let's now start in detail from the upper layer, topmost layer. So we will go through this course in a top-down approach, starting from the application layer, then to the transport layer, network layer, data link layer, and physical layer. Okay. So let's start today with application layer, which is the topmost layer on the TCP/IP stack, and all the applications we are using in our daily life are on the application layer. For example, you are using any YouTube video or any instant messaging service, for example Skype or Facebook, Twitter, web browsing, email checking. Okay, all these applications are being used on the application layer because someone has designed these applications, and we are using these internet applications. All the applications are on the application layer, and to use these applications definitely on the application layer, we do need some protocols, application layer protocols, because these applications do need the services of the protocols. If there are no protocols on the application layer, we can't use these applications, because application layer is a platform which provides us the services. Okay, and these services are being provided with the help of the protocols which are available on that layer, that particular layer, because we studied in our last lectures that each layer will provide set of services. Okay, so who will provide set of services on that particular layer? The protocols which are there inside that layer, on that layer. So every application does need the services of the protocols on the application layer. Okay, for example, we will be using different applications on the application layer, and each application will require some services from the protocols. Okay, so the topics which we will be covering in this chapter will be principles. The first topic will be principles of network applications, how the network, what are the principles for the network application. Most of the applications we are using nowadays on the internet, these are the network applications, definitely, either in terms of point-to-point applications or client-server applications, okay, web browsing, and the protocol which is being used in between the web client and the web browser and the web server, FTP file server protocol, file transfer protocol, hypertext transfer protocol. For the electronic emails which we are using in our daily life, we will be using SMTP protocol, simple mail transfer protocol, post office protocol, internet message access protocol. Okay, these are the protocols. This protocol is used to transfer the email. Okay, these two protocols are used to retrieve the emails from the mailbox of the users on the mail server. Okay, by using these two protocols, we can retrieve the emails from the mail servers of the users, from the mailboxes of the users on the mail servers. Okay, DNS is another protocol on the application layer which is used for the domain name system, means the translation of the URL, the website names will be translated into the IP addresses with the help of this protocol. Point-to-point application, socket programming using UDP protocol, user datagram protocol, or socket programming with the help of transmission control protocol on the transport layer. So all these protocols we looked onto, for example, HTTP, FTP, SMTP, POP3, IMAP, DNS, Okay, these are the protocols on the application layer. Many others protocols are there. Okay, for example, Telnet is there. Okay, so these are the common application layer protocols which we are using in our daily life. Okay, clear? Our goal in this chapter will be to study the conceptual implementation aspect of the network application protocols, how the application layer protocols are being implemented, okay, transport layer service models and client server paradigm, peer-to-peer paradigm, learn about the protocols by examining popular application level protocols. For example, on this application layer, what are the popular protocols which are being used in our daily life? HTTP, FTP, SMTP, POP3, IMAP, DNS, Telnet, okay? Programming network applications with the help of socket programming and application programming interface APIs, socket APIs. Some of the network applications which we are using in our daily life, okay, on the internet. For example, we are checking our email daily. Definitely, this email service will require some protocols on the application layer. How this email service will be, how this email service is functional on the internet. Okay, that implementation is basically written or hidden inside the application layer, and that service is provided on the application layer with the help of the protocols which are available on the application layer to provide these service, this service, this particular service. So we looked into it, okay, SMTP, POP3, IMAP, okay. Web browsing, okay, web browsing means you open a web browser, you open up a web browser on your client computer and you want to access a web server. And from that web server you will access a web page. And that web server will be the web server of a company where the where that particular website is hosted, which you, whose URL you are writing into the web browser. For example, if you are writing www.google.com into your web browser, so the request from your web client, web browser, will go on the internet towards the web server of the Google. So this will be a client server architecture, and this is a client server architecture application, web browsing, instant messaging, any messaging service. If you use Yahoo Messenger, Google Messenger, or the MSN Messenger, or in the Skype, instant messages you are exchanging daily in your daily life with the peers. Okay, remote login service, Telnet is a protocol on the application layer which provides the service of remote login, that you can get into remote computer, you can connect to a remote computer and get its access remotely. You can log in onto a computer by sitting on your own computer. Point-to-point file sharing between two nodes, you can share the file. Multi-user network games, nowadays multiplayer games are there. Okay, and these games are not being played on to the same network, onto the network, even not on the LAN, on the WAN, on the internet you can play the games. The PS3 and PS4, these are the examples, very famous examples by the Sony company, and people are using these games, and there is a community of the player. You have to register on that community by creating your login password, and then if you both are having the same game on your device, you can share it and you can play with each other, multiplayer games. Okay, streaming stored video clips, YouTube is a good example. These clips are stored on the YouTube server, and you can stream them from the those videos from the YouTube server. Social network websites are there, Twitter, Facebook, so many other are there, Fanbox, like these. Voice over IP service. The migration has started from the ordinary telephone to the internet telephone, which is the voice over IP telephone called. On one cable, you can get three services. It is called triple play. Now the one single optical fiber is coming in the home and is terminated onto your modem, on which you can get the telephone service, internet service, as well as the TV service, cable TV. So all the three services you are getting on the one single wire. We call it triple play. Okay, so real-time video conferencing in the universities, for example. Okay. Here we are teaching to boys, and on other side we are teaching to the girl. At the same time, the girls are also listening and watching the slides, whatever are being presented over here. They are getting a live video, lecture slides, and delivery of the lecture there. And they can ask the questions at the same time, live. This is all possible due to the help of real-time video conferencing. That grid computing is there, cloud computing is there. How all these are possible? Due to the help of the network applications. For all these services, you do have the network applications, and these applications are being designed keeping in view the protocols which are available on the application layers, and these, the developer of these applications, they do use the services of the application layer protocols in their application programs in order to provide these services. Is it clear? Creating a network application . The developer has to write a application program that will run where? On the end systems, on the different end systems, and it will communicate over the network. The end systems, as we have studied in chapter number 1, these are connected with the network, with the internet, through your gateway router. And the end system, on the end system, the application program will be running, which will be providing all these services. Different application programs are there to provide different type of services, and these application programs will communicate over the network, either on a peer-to-peer architecture or on the based of on the or they will be based on the client server architecture. Example, web server software is written for the web server, and it communicates with the web browser client or browser software. So web server software will communicate with the web server software. For example, you have a client here, web client. This is the web client. It will be running an application which is web browser. So web browser will request a web page from the web server. So this will be running, this computer on the internet will be running a web server. Okay, and here you will host your web site containing the web pages. All the web pages are hosted as a website over this web server, which will be using HTTP protocol. Okay, and here this web client on your computer, with the help of a web browser, will, by using HTTP protocol, will request a web page. Okay, and this request from this computer will be sent over to the internet. And definitely, this Google web server, for example, is over the internet available. So this web server request will go to the web client request, will go to the web server over the internet, and the web server will give a reply. This is a request, and in the reply you will get a index.com, index.html page, which will be the front page or the home page of the Google website, and the page will be opened up here. Google web page opened here on this web client. So this is a client server architecture. This is a web client. This is a web server. Web client is sending a web page request to the web server, and web server is returning a web page to this client. Definitely there are some other factors which will be kept in mind, because this request will not directly go to the web server. It will first go to a DNS server to get resolve its IP address, because we do need its IP address, the IP address of the this URL, which is the Google web server IP address, and that request will be resolved by the DNS server. So first it will go to the DNS server, because we looked into our last slides that DNS is another service on the application layer. So before our request goes to the web server, it goes to a DNS server on our local network, and it is resolved, the URL is resolved into an IP address, and then the request is sent on to that IP address on the internet, because the routers are the devices over the internet which will understand only the IP addresses, not the names. Okay, because these are the devices, network layer devices, layer 3 devices, and on the layer 3 we use the addresses, IP addresses. So definitely for this URL we do need a corresponding IP address, and then the request can be transported over layer 3 on the network layer, because network layer understands the IP addresses. So the request will be sent on these, the routers will send the request to this particular destination network on which the Google web server is located, and then the ultimate destination web server will receive this request, and it will send reply back to the client, because that request does contain in it the source IP address from where the request came actually. So the reply will go back to that client in terms of a web page which will be displayed there. So this is the structure that how a web client communicate with a web server over the internet. Okay, so definitely the developers have written a program, network application, for this purpose. No need to write software for network core devices. So this is the end devices, web client and web server. But in between the source computer and the destination computer, there are a lot of network devices. Okay, so we do not need the applications for the network core devices. Rather, these devices do have operating system, and that operating system is called the IOS, Internetwork Operating System, which is used by these devices in order to control the functionality of these devices, or to configure these devices, or to configure the routing protocol on these devices, how to route the traffic which will be coming to these intermediary devices. These are the intermediate devices, and the intermediate devices will be getting a request which should be forwarded to the proper destination, from where the reply should come back to the computer who has initiated or who has sent a request. So these intermediary devices does not need some sort of application programs. Rather, these devices do need operating systems, okay, internetwork operating system. So network core devices do not run user applications. User applications are run on the end devices, either on the client side or on the server side. The client application will run on the client computer, client and computer, and the server application will run on the server host. And the client application will run on the client computer, client host. Okay. So application on the end systems will allow for the rapid application development and propagation from one client to another client. Okay. So these are the end clients. Either these are the clients which will be running the client applications. Okay. These are the client computers which will be running the client applications. And these are the servers which will be running the server application. So in our example, might be this is the web client and its request will be forwarded by the intermediary devices to the web server, Google web server. Clear? Is the concept clear to you guys? About the DNS, you could think that inside its local area network, there we can have a server over here to give the DNS service. So its request first will go to its local area network. Its URL will be resolved into an IP address, and then on that IP address, its router will forward the request. DNS is itself a server application, and the job of the DNS server is whatever URL you are writing in the browser to resolve it, to translate it into the corresponding IP address. Then the layer 3 device router will route the traffic on that particular IP address. It will look that is I can route this request to this particular network. If that network is available in my routing table, it's mean I can route, I can send the request to this network. We will study this working of the DNS server in detail in our next coming slides, okay? Right now, I'm giving you an overview that how on the network, the end hosts will communicate with the server host. So these are the end devices which will be running the client applications, and these are the servers, end servers, which will be hosting or running the server application. So in our scenario, these could be the client, web client computers running the client application, which is a web browser, any browser, Internet Explorer, Google Chrome, or Mozilla, Firefox, or Netscape Navigator. These all are the web client browsers. Okay. Web client browser, yeah. Yeah, it does contain the functionality of the network layer, okay, and even the data link layer, and it also deals with the physical layer, because router is a layer 3 device, and it will take care of the layer 3, layer 2, and layer 1. Any device on a particular layer can work on that particular layer and the layer under it, below it. Clear? Computer is a general purpose device. It can work starting from the application layer until the physical layer. Starting from top layer, application layer, because you run application on the computer. It is a computer. Okay. That is why it is called a general purpose device. Because it can work on all the five layers. Application layer, transport layer. Application layer, you are running a lot of applications on the computer. Transport layer, in terms of many processes are running for all these applications on the transport layer, and every process is listening on a different port in order to differentiate between the request and the replies of different processes for different application programs. And then you assign with your own hands an IP address to a computer. So it is a layer 3 device also, because you are assigning an IP address to this computer. Clear? Then it comes down to the data link layer, because the network card which is installed in this computer, it does has a hardware address, physical address, MAC address. It is a layer 2 device also. And on the physical layer, have you connected a cable into your desktop computer? Yeah. Either you connected it with the copper cable, with the optical fiber cable, or with the wireless link with the network. So this computer has a direct interface with your network. Physically connected with your network, either through the wired media or wireless media, irrespective of any type of media is used. But this computer is physically connected, it has a physical connection on the physical layer with your network and with the immediate device where this computer is being connected. Clear? So, look here, every device, this laptop is connected with this access point with the help of a wireless link. This desktop is connected with this router with the help of our switch, with the help of a wired link. Okay, this is a LAN here. We have a switch here because we want to connect more than one computers with this router on this port. And on this port, we want to connect multiple computers. So we do need a switch here. A switch here. These are the laptops with the wireless access link and have a connection with the wireless access point. These are the servers connected to a router with the help of a switch. Clear, boys? Is there any question? Good. Look here. These are two client computers. They are running the client applications. This might be a web server. And it is running a server application. Web server. I have written here, web server, web client. It will be running a hosting a website, web pages, using that web service. And this web client will use a web browser, client application. In order to access, in order to transfer a request, in order to get a reply through this client application. Because without client application, the client computer can't communicate with the web server, because web server definitely receive or send requests to the web client, to and from the web client. It will receive requests from the web client and it will send replies to the web client. So the client machine should have an application which is called the client application. So on these client machines, the client application will be running on the application layer. And on the server, you will be running a server application on the application layer. Let's take, assume it is a web server, and these two are the clients which are running a client application, like a web browser, and they are requesting a web page. Clear? But definitely, the application layer on the client machines will contact the application layer on the server machine. A manager in a company will definitely try to interact with the manager of the other company. Below the manager, beneath the manager, there will be a supervisor. So supervisor will communicate with the supervisor. So transport layer will communicate with the transport layer. Application mean manager will communicate with the manager. Transport layer supervisor will communicate with the supervisor. Below it, there will be workers, and worker will deal with the worker, or you could say the secretary will deal with the secretary on the network layer. And below it, you will have data link or the physical layer. You could say the messenger, Qasid. Okay, so the messenger on the physical layer will deal with the messenger on the physical layer of the other company, and they will transport the messages. They will exchange the messages, risala. Is it clear? So this is the hierarchy, bil tartib. Okay. So bill the manager will try to communicate on the application layer of one company to the messenger of the other company on the physical layer? No. There is a one-to-one correspondence. Have you seen the animation? We have run on the net-seal.net. There is a line from every layer to every layer. Application to application, transport to transport. Have you seen the lines? This is the example of those lines. Manager with the manager on the application layer. Okay. Supervisor with the supervisor on the transport layer. On the network layer. The secretary with the secretary to arrange the meetings. Okay. And on the physical data link and physical layer. Messenger with the messenger who will transport the physical bits, messages. Clear? So principle of the network application, okay, the first topic, application architecture. Is it a client-server architecture? or it is a point-to-point architecture. Client-server architecture, including data centers, cloud computing, and Google has invested a lot of amount on their data centers. This is one of the example of the Google Web Server. We will be looking into detail. Point-to-point is direct connection between two computers, point-to-point application, but it will not be definitely a direct connection, as two computers cannot be directly connected over the internet. Definitely they have to be indirect connections. It has to be an indirect connection between these two computers, or it could be a hybrid of client-server and point-to-point architectures. This is a very good and interesting example. We will be looking into it and we will discuss it. Yeah, Skype, very good. Client-server architecture. This is the client-server architecture. Server will be running a server application and it will be always on host 24/7. Okay. Permanent IP address should be assigned to the server computers. They should not be assigned the IP address from the DHCP server. Server farms should be there for the scaling of the servers. If in future you want to put more servers, you can add the servers in the server farm. Server farm is a separate place where you will keep the servers only. And whenever you want, you can connect more servers in the server farm with the network and start giving more services. In order to give each type of service, you should have a server in your company and it should be connected to your network. So you should have a place reserved in your company which is called a server farm, okay, where you will place the servers and connect them to the network in order to provide an additional service or different type of service, whatever service you want to provide. Okay? We have looked into different type of so many services. Okay. Why the server should have a fixed IP address? Yes, Bashir. Why a server should have a fixed IP address, not dynamic, static IP address? Why? Yes. Always on is another property. Fixed IP is another property. Anybody? As I told you just now that we should have a DNS server in our network, and DNS server will have a mapping in between the URL and the IP address. This IP should be fixed. Then that entry can be put into the database of the DNS server that Google has this IP address fixed. Okay? If this is keep on changing, so every time you have to update your database of the DNS server in order to update this IP address. So the IP, usually the IPs to the servers are assigned fixed IPs, okay, not to the DHCP server. So these are kept fixed so that their entries should be propagated over the internet, and these entries should be entered into the maximum DNS servers of the company so that whoever is going to request Google web page, its IP can easily be available from the DNS server database of that company. Because every company, on every host, we are opening Google daily. So almost all the DNS servers in the world, in all the companies' network, they do have this entry in their databases on the fixed IP addresses, depending upon the location where their host is located. Because the nearest Google server is going to serve that host. And Google server has placed so many Google servers in the world for load balancing, load sharing, sharing the traffic between different Google servers. Because definitely it will not be possible for one Google server to serve million or billions of requests. It will die definitely. So they have distributed the Google servers into different region of the world in order to serve the traffic, okay, easily. Clear?
So,
yeah, different IP address. So clients communicate with the server, okay, the request from the client will go to the server, okay, maybe intermittently, okay, connected intermittently, irregularly, not all the times they will be connected, the client will be connected with the server irregularly, whenever you want you can connect your client with the server, okay. May have dynamic IP address, may have dynamic IP address, and do not communicate directly with each other. Definitely this client computer is not directly connected with this web server. There are how many routers coming in between? If this computer is going to send a request to this server, you can look here, it will jump one router, two router, okay, three routers, four routers, five routers. So there are in between the source computer and the destination computer, there are five hops in between this source and this destination. So this is the meaning, do not communicate directly with each other, there are intermediate five hops in between the source and the destination, and the five hops will route your message from the source, taking from the source, first hop will send it to the second, second will send it to the third, third it will send it to the fourth, fourth will send it to the fifth, and fifth will finally send it to the destination computer, which is a web server of the Google, for example. Your computer is, when you are sending a request of the Google web page, it does not go directly to the Google web server. It reaches there by going through the intermediate hops which are there in between you and the final destination. Clear? A DNS will be there inside. If you put another server here, it will be DNS inside it. I will come to the DNS. We will do a complete lab for the DNS in Packet Tracer as well as, and it will be in your local network. The DNS server will be located in your local network, okay, because it has to resolve the URL into IP, and then the IP will be given to the router, and router will route the traffic to that IP. It will be in-house translation, local, on the local area network. Clear? Look here, these clients on the network, they are the clients, they are communicating with different servers. So this is called a client-server architecture. Google data center, estimated cost of the data center of the Google is approximately $600 million. Google spent $2.4 billion in 2007 on the new data centers. Each data center uses 50 to 100 megawatts of the power. This is the power consumption of the data centers. Pure point-to-point architecture. I'm going to stop here. So the time for the lecture is finished. From here we will continue in the next lecture. We will be having a quiz on Thursday for the chapter number 1, okay? Because we finished chapter number 1. So we will have a quiz on Thursday for chapter number 1, okay? Thank you guys.